I'm John Sarlin, and welcome to Nightcap. The markets are closed, but we're still open. First up, a Twitter whistleblower has come forward with big accusation. Now, he's heading to Capitol Hill. What it means for Twitter. Then, the White House has finally announced their plan for student loan forgiveness. Is it enough? Is it too much? And last, quiet quitting. What it means and why it matters. But first, this week, Peter Mudge Zatko emerged as the Twitter whistleblower, alleging that Twitter has jeopardized U.S. national security and misled investors and regulators. Claire Duffy was one of the CNN reporters who broke the story. Claire, good to see you. Since your story published, we've just learned that Zatko is now going to testify at a Senate hearing in September. What do you think lawmakers are going to be most interested in about from his allegations?
Yeah, John, a lot has happened in the 48 hours since this story broke. Funnily enough, that hearing is going to be on September 13th, which is the same day that Twitter shareholders are set to vote on whether to approve Musk's takeover deal for the company. So just interesting timing there. I think at this hearing, we'll expect to hear lawmakers ask a lot about user data privacy. That's something they certainly have shown they've cared about increasingly over the past couple of years. I also think they're going to want to know a lot about these allegations that Twitter security vulnerabilities threaten U.S. national security. You know, I expect they might ask him how Twitter is preparing to handle the upcoming midterm elections and whether they're really capable of dealing with the potential threats that we could see there. And one of the things that we've heard when we're talking to people who have worked with Peter Zatko, who know him, is that he has a knack for sort of explaining these really complex technical cybersecurity concepts to lay people, to, you know, corporate executives and to lawmakers. And so I expect that this will sort of get in the weeds and he'll be sort of trying to help lawmakers understand the more technical side of these cybersecurity issues within Twitter.
I want to ask you about Twitter's response to your story and to the allegations. This is from their statement that they provided to CNN, which was, Mr. Zatko was fired from his senior executive role at Twitter in January 2022 for ineffective leadership and poor performance. Twitter also called Zatko's allegations a false narrative riddled with inconsistencies and inaccuracies. So they gave that statement, but they really haven't provided specifics here to push back. Were you surprised that Twitter hasn't more directly responded to his, you know, very detailed allegations here?
Yeah, I think, you know, Twitter did, as you said, broadly defended itself against these allegations. It provided sort of bullet point list of ways in which it felt the disclosure misrepresented the work of the company or ways in which its policies have advanced beyond what Zatko's disclosure alleges. But I do think we haven't seen the sort of specific evidentiary pushback that you might expect in a case like this. A good example of this is that we asked Twitter about one of the allegations in the disclosure, in which Zatko claimed that the company regularly fails to delete user data when they deactivate their accounts. And that would be in direct violation of the company's 2011 FTC consent order. When we asked Twitter about this, Twitter says that when users request to cancel their accounts, the company deactivates the accounts and starts the process of deleting data, but it didn't ever say whether it actually completes the process of deleting that data.
I want to ask you about Elon Musk, who has been surprisingly quiet about the news, considering that the revelations of it could have serious ramifications for his legal battle on trying to buy Twitter. What do you make of his reaction?
Yeah, you know, obviously this does really have fortuitous timing for Elon Musk. His battle with Twitter over whether or not he's going to be forced to buy the company goes to trial in October. So it's interesting that we haven't heard quite as much from him, given, you know, his sort of reputation. He did tweet a meme the day that the news came out, which is not entirely surprising. But while we haven't heard directly from Elon very much, we have heard from his lawyers. His lawyers brought up the whistleblower in a hearing yesterday in the case against Twitter. They say that they want to hear from Zatko. Apparently, they had actually subpoenaed Zatko in the case prior to the reporting on this coming out. So this is clearly someone that they want to hear from. And it'll be interesting to see what effect this has on the case.
Claire, thank you for coming on. This week, the Biden administration has announced its long-awaited plan for student loan forgiveness. The details: $20,000 forgiven if you went to college on Pell Grants, $10,000 forgiven if you don't have Pell Grants. To qualify, individuals have to make less than $125,000 a year, and a final pause of student loan payments will last until the end of the year. Joining us is Washington Post opinion columnist and CNN commentator, Catherine Rampell. Catherine, I know you have been critical of this plan. You have been talking about its potential inflationary effects. Here is President Biden addressing those concerns.
By resuming student loan payments at the same time as we provide targeted relief, we're taking an economically responsible course. As a consequence, about $50 billion a year will start coming back into the Treasury because of the resumption of debt. Independent experts agree that these actions taken together will provide real benefits for families without meaningful effect on inflation.
Right. So the Biden and the White House are saying, okay, yes, we'll be forgiving these loans, but also these payments will begin again. So that will be money coming out of the economy. What do you say to that?
Well, he's right about that. I mean, I'm not sure that he should bundle those things together and get credit for both of them. Payments were supposed to resume eventually anyway, whenever the public emergency ends. But that said, I actually am not so worried about the inflationary effects anyway, even if you're only isolating the effects of the forgiveness itself. Directionally, yes, it is likely to be inflationary. You are effectively cutting a lot of Americans a check of $10,000 or $20,000. It's not as liquid as an actual check, but you know, the idea is that they will have more money long term, and they may spend some of it.
So if not inflation, then what are your biggest concerns with the plan?
My concerns about this program is that essentially it's overbroad. There are Americans who are desperately struggling with the burden of student loan debt. They include people who were defrauded by fly-by-night for-profit institutions that never planned on delivering a useful education. There are people who enrolled in college or various other post-secondary programs, never got a degree, so they took on the debt. They never got the return on that investment. There are other people who maybe got a degree, but it's kind of worthless, at least in terms of how the marketplace, the labor market, views it. Those are people who I do think need help, who we should be helping. And in fact, Biden has been helping. He's been helping people who have been defrauded by ITT Tech and other institutions that have been shut down. He's been helping people who have been mired in the morass that is the public service loan forgiveness program, for example. So some of those things are good, but those are not the only things they're doing. They're actually forgiving debt for households making as much as $250,000. The headline number has been $125,000. That's the income cutoff. But for married couples, it's $250,000. And that's basically the 95th percentile of the income distribution.
You're not the only one who's skeptical about this, right? There's this kind of split emerging where liberal economists are skeptical about this plan. We're seeing some centrist Democrats criticizing it. But then we're seeing progressive activists laud it, saying, yes, this isn't a perfect plan, but this will be a real benefit to millions of Americans, right? This was a campaign promise that Biden was elected on. And then also we've seen people talk about the huge tax cuts and the PPP loans that went out during the pandemic. What would you say to someone who looks at that and says, for all things considered, this is a solid plan?
So on the point about the Trump tax cuts or all the PPP fraud, I agree. That was bad. I've written like dozens of columns talking about how poorly designed the Trump tax cuts were, how they were weighted to the wealthy, how they were sold, you know, on a bill of goods, essentially, that they, you know, that there was, it was basically a trickle-down story that did not materialize. I don't know. First of all, I can be critical of both things. Second of all, just because one set of policies was poorly designed and very expensive doesn't necessarily mean that we should do another set of policies that's also poorly designed and you know, unnecessarily expensive. So that argument doesn't particularly resonate with me.
Catherine, thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
And last, it seems like everyone is suddenly talking about quiet quitting. That's hard to say. Quiet quitting, the buzzy term that describes the phenomenon of people choosing not to work more than they have to. The conversation exploded after this TikTok went viral.
I recently learned about this term called quiet quitting, where you're not outright quitting your job, but you're quitting the idea of going above and beyond. You're still performing your duties, but you're no longer subscribing to the hustle culture mentality that work has to be your life.
So there's a TikTok hashtag with nearly 30 million views of quiet quitting. There are think pieces in pretty much every newspaper you can think of. So joining us to discuss this now is CNN's Allison Morrow. Allison, you had your own very good piece about this. So the phrase is like a bit of a misnomer, right? Because people aren't actually quitting their jobs here. What are they quitting?
Yeah, it's really struck a nerve, this term, quiet quitting. And I think what's important to know is that millions of people are actually quitting their jobs every month still in this really tight labor market. But what quiet quitting refers to is really just quitting the crappy parts of your job. The performative overperformance, I've called it. You know, it's the hustle culture, it's the lean in, it's the hashtag girl boss. People are tired and they're really just realizing that they can do their job, do it competently, work 9 to 5 or whatever their boss asks them to do, and no more. I think, you know, the term quiet quitting means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, but at the end of the day, it's kind of just work-life balance, setting up boundaries and saying, I'm going to work these hours, I'm going to do this amount of work, and then I'm done. And so I think that's what's really struck a nerve, especially right now, you know, as we're 2+ years into a pandemic that has a lot of people working from home still, you know, especially younger people are drawing a line in the sand and saying, this is what I'm going to do, and I'm not going to make work my entire life.
There's been a bit of a backlash, though, against the term, right? People are saying the term itself is kind of being used to demonize those workers who you're mentioning, who are drawing this line and saying they are just working the amount of work they were hired to do. Tell me about that.
Yeah, it wouldn't be a trendy buzzword without a backlash, right? So the backlash, as I understand it, is kind of a backlash against the media's adoption of the term and kind of, you know, we're all guilty. We've all written a million hot takes on it. But I think that's because our audience is so interested in hearing about this idea of setting up boundaries. But the people who are doing the boundary setting and who are quote unquote quiet quitting don't want that to be perceived as a controversial thing. They think that's just what we should be doing anyway, and we shouldn't scandalize it or make it more than it is. And I think that the backlash we're seeing now is, you know, it's been a couple of weeks since the term first, I think, was published in the Wall Street Journal, and that article went viral, and then the TikTok was going viral. So we're in like this work culture transition moment right now. And I think the term itself can be a little jarring depending on what you take away from it.
So is this really new? You wrote about Office Space, which is one of my favorite movies, where he's kind of like the original quiet quitter. I think we have a clip.
I generally come in at least 15 minutes late. I use the side door. That way Lumber can't see me. and after that, I just sort of space out for about an hour.
Space out?
Yeah, I just stare at my desk, but it looks like I'm working.
The original quiet quitter. Right there. So is this really a new thing?
I think that's exactly right. It's not a new thing, but it is a new term that kind of crystallizes this moment. You know, that movie, I think, was an extreme example of quiet quitting, but it was really kind of wrapped in a Gen X slacker culture facade, which is really amusing. And frankly, that movie holds up. I rewatched it recently.
All right. Well, thank you, Allison. I'm glad you haven't quiet quitted yet, or maybe you have. I don't know. Don't tell.
No loud quitting or quiet quitting right now.
All right. That's good. That's all from us. Don't forget to sign up for the Nightcap newsletter at cnn.com/nightcap and join us again next week right here at 4 p.m. at CNN Business. Thanks for watching.